Hey everyone, it's Carl from Small Step, and today I want to talk about some of the differences between the web PKI and internal PKIs that you see in organizations. So in the web PKI, this is how I think most of us come into contact with certificates in the first place. We either run into a certificate error on a website, or we click on the lock icon and dig into the certificate details. These certificates are kind of like a monoculture. It's like there's billions of the same kind of certificate on the web PKI. And they're issued by just a couple hundred CAs around the world. And they're all publicly trusted because you download the root CA certificates. They come with every web browser. So there's a lot of constraints around these certificates that keep them looking pretty much the same. There are different server names, but the properties of the certificate are very constrained to the specific use case of websites and server authentication. When you get into internal PKI, it's more like a jungle. You've got a lot of different use cases, and there's a lot of customization going on, and certificates can be used for many different purposes. They might not even be used for TLS at all. You could use certificates for document signing. You can use certificates for code signing, all kinds of other purposes. And so you see a lot more variety in an internal PKI. All right, so let's run through some of the differences between these worlds. In the web PKI, we have TLS server certificates. And in internal PKIs, we've got all kinds of certificates. We've got X509, certificates of different styles for like VPN, Wi-Fi, could be IoT devices, document signing, code signing, SSH certificates, which are a completely different format from X509. In the web PKI, the validity period is a maximum of 90 days. It may soon be even shorter than that, but most of the web certificates you'll see out there are going to have a 90-day validity period. And in internal PKIs, it really depends on your threat model and your security policy. An SSH certificate for accessing a really sensitive host, for example, might only last for 5 minutes. Whereas a device certificate where the private key is bound to hardware, that might last a year. Because if the private key is bound to hardware, then it's not exportable and it can't be stolen. So there's a lot of security around that. And you can have certificates that last as long as a year there or a couple of years. In the web PKI, you have dozens of CAs around the world, all forming a single global unified zone of trust for browsers accessing public websites. And with internal CAs, you might have multiple trust zones. So this would look like several root certificates, and those root certificates might play a different role within the organization. For example, maybe you would have a CA that's just for clients on the Wi-Fi and devices. If you had that, then you know that anyone who has a certificate from that CA, it is going to be just for the Wi-Fi, and it's not gonna like get you into a database server, right? And then you might have another one over here that's just for server certificates for internal websites. And so you have these different trust zones that are treated differently by the software inside of your infrastructure. On the web PKI, the certificates have to have really broad compatibility. So they're very constrained in terms of what they can contain. There's an organization called the CA Browser Forum that sets down these baseline requirements. This is where all of the certificate authorities in the web PKI and all the like web browser developers come together and figure out how to make the most compatible certificate. And then that is what they all agree on, what properties that certificate can have. And that's what the web PKI consists of, is that kind of certificate that meets the baseline requirements of the CA Browser Forum. Now, in internal PKIs, I think one of the big benefits of an internal PKI is that you can do customization, right? You can customize certificates to fit any particular application that you have. So like imagine a gateway, like an application gateway, where you want to be able to have certificates with all of the things on them that you would need to make a policy decision in that gateway. Then you might have lots of properties on your certificate, subject alternative names, you might have a bunch of email addresses. You can put anything on there that you want and bind it to the public key. You could put tags into a certificate, you could put location information, device information, things like what version of the firmware are you running? Has your system sort of passed certain device posture checks lately? Things like that can go onto certificates, and that way the gateway, like a gateway service, could be looking at those and making sort of policy decisions based on what it sees. So there's a lot of room for customization, both in terms of what goes on the certificate, but also just like how certificates are sort of geared toward different applications in internal PKI. Another example would be like document signing, where you need something called an LTV certificate that is signed with uses a timestamping server to have a signed timestamp that goes in with the certificate and the document is signed with. So you have a PDF at a law firm that gets signed with assigned a timestamp. So it allows someone far into the future to validate that that actually was the time that the thing was signed, that the document was signed, and that somebody didn't just change the clock on their computer and then sign it. Another difference is in the Web PKI, you see certificate transparency. It's part of the Web PKI, and this is an immutable log. You can take a look at it at crt.sh, and I'm sure there's other websites for browsing it. It's a public log of all of the certificates that are issued on the Web PKI. And this is really useful because you can catch any kind of rogue certificate being created. It's all happening in public. It's append only. There can't be any changes to this log. It's less common to see certificate of transparency logs inside internal PKIs. Maybe that may have to do with the volume of certificates that are being issued. It may have to do with the unique nature of the Web PKI and how it's distributed and how many certificates it deals with compared to most internal PKIs, which are generally smaller than the Web PKI. I can't imagine that there's an internal PKI that's bigger than the Web PKI, but maybe. And then implicitly trusted versus explicitly trusted. For this one, when you download a web browser, you get trust of all of the root CAs that comprise the Web PKI. And you don't have to approve individual root CAs. You just get this bundle, you get a trust bundle of all the certificates from the Web PKI installed into your computer. And most people, you don't have to think about it, and you shouldn't have to think about it, because a lot of folks have already thought about this for us and do a lot of work to maintain this web of trusted certificate authorities. So you have this implicit trust. With internal PKIs, the certificate authorities have to be explicitly trusted, and they're often trusted on a system-wide level. This is like something that can happen the problem or the challenge that's built into this is root distribution, right? When you're running an internal PKI, you have to distribute your root CA certificate to all your clients somehow. This is often done using mobile device management because you can push certificates down to clients. You can push CA certificates to them and get that kind of trust set up. But it just depends. The point is that you're not just going to get automatic trust of your internal CA in an internal PKI. It's something that you have to configure and set up. Another difference is that in the Web PKI, you've got server authentication certificates, and that's it. So these are certificates with a server's domain name on them, and they only are configured to allow for server authentication. In the internal PKI, you can use certificates for client authentication as well. So maybe a certificate has an email address on it for of a client, of a person, and it's issued to a person. Maybe it resides on a smart card, and they have to put the smart card in the computer to sign in. You don't see that on the Web PKI. Code signing certificates, document signing certificates, these things don't exist on the Web PKI. SMIME certificates for email, right? That's a completely different world. And then finally, we have active versus passive revocation. In the Web PKI, active revocation is used, and this allows certificate authorities to revoke certificates immediately. And there's a lot of mechanisms. OCSP and CRL are the protocols that are used to make this possible so that you can issue a certificate and distribute it, but then it can be revoked at any time. And there's a revocation check that happens at different points, like when a website is accessed and stuff like that. And then in an internal PKI, you can have either active or passive revocation. So you could use OCSP and CRL, or you could just have certificates that are shorter lived. If your certificate only lasts a day or an hour or a few minutes, then you get what's called passive revocation. You can, if someone steals that certificate in private key, it's of like a lot less value if it only lasts a few minutes than if it lasts 90 days. So passive revocation is when you tell the certificate authority not to allow renewal of a certificate of a certain serial number. So even if it's stolen, yes, it can be used by the attacker until it expires, but it can't be renewed. That's how passive revocation works. And you don't really see that on the Web PKI. So I hope this video has helped clarify some of the differences between the Web PKI and internal PKIs. All right, thanks for watching.